Hello and welcome to Radio Book Club on CFCR. My name is Anne Foster. This week I'm joined in the studio by Saskatoon debut author Curtis Anderson about his book, which possibly has the most attention-grabbing title of any book published this year, not just in Saskatoon, but a lot of places. Gina French is Not a Waste of Roofies. So this is the story of a woman who was working as a prison guard and then finds herself embroiled in a kind of noirish nightmare. It was published by Kraken Press just a few months ago, and Curtis joined me in the studio to talk about this very unusual and very interesting book. Girl, I observed you change your position, and you're changing me, causing me shadow. So I'm joined today in the studio by Curtis Anderson. Welcome, Curtis.
Well, thank you very much for having me, Annabelle.
So we're here talking about your book, which, until I read it, I kept forgetting the title. I'm like, something, 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 Roofies. And then I was just like, oh, the Roofies book. I'm interviewing the Roofies guy today. But anyway,
it's very rewarding when people go into a bookstore and ask for the book by title. Just having, you know, friends and friends' mothers going, do you have Gina French is Not a Waste of Roofies? It's just, it makes me smile.
My question is, well, we're going to get into what the book is about and everything, but did you consider changing the title, or were you always like 100% committed to the title?
I didn't even know this was the title for the first half of writing it. And it actually came from, I won't tell you the whole story, but it is actually a quote from a former coworker that was like, a tasteless joke was made and then she trumped it, which took the power back. And I was like, wow, that's such a, I don't know if the word's harsh, but just like jarring sentence. Mm-hmm. So I kind of hijacked her offensive Trump and committed it to the book title and wrote it in. And it jumps out at you. It's kind of marketing 101. I was working with a few publishers that didn't bite. Obviously, they were like, we're not going to run with this title. They like it, but how do you market something like that? It just wasn't a fit for them. But Kraken Press was all for it. So it was actually surprising. I called it the working title right up till I actually saw it on the cover. When I was sent the first published draft, there it was.
Yeah.
It's kind of surprising.
Well, and that's the thing. If the book was called, like, The Chase or something, like, 1,000 books are called that.
Right?
Like, nothing else has this title.
I think what was my original thought? It was going to be, like, Victims of Paradise or something. I don't even know if that's trademarked or not. If anyone out there wants to steal that, go for it. But, and again, it just was like, yeah, you know, you see that on the shelf and it doesn't pop out. What can I do that's different?
Yeah.
And the lady I worked with at the time just handed me a million dollar bill.
Well, what I think is good about the title too, and what I think it's good to keep the title on the book, is it sets people up for a certain sort of expectation. Yeah. If it was called, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
People are like, what's this book? But this is like, people who are not going to enjoy it are not going to pick it up.
Yep.
So
it's definitely a filter, and it makes me happy for the most part, but sometimes it's heartbreaking. Like, I have good friends that were just like, I'm actually, you know, no matter what they say, it's coming out in my ears going, I am judging your book by its title.
Yeah.
And they will never read it just because of the title, which again is a little heartbreaking, but they know they're walking away and not gonna read something they probably won't enjoy, so.
Well, exactly. So it's the filtering
aspect
as well.
And so, it needs a filter, I think.
Yeah.
It's pretty dark for a prairie writer.
It really is. It's sort of on the, I would say, like the Chuck Palahniuk sort of side of things.
Thank you. I'm okay with that.
So people who like that would be into this. Like, it's very, do you want to talk a bit about what the story of it is?
Sure, go ahead.
So we've got Gina French, who is, at the surface, people going into a book like this with an expectation. We have a woman who's been victimized. She's in this sort of like underdog status.
Yes.
You expect to sympathize with her, to see her as this kind of like martyr struggling through stuff, and she is not that.
No. Usually when I throw it out to horror movie people, are like, oh, so it's like I spit on your grave. Well, no, it's not. It's not at all. Because usually when writers are portraying, you know, female victims of sexual assault, they're always just the best people in the world.
And
you
have so much immediate.
It's the librarian walking home, right? Yeah. So I went the other way and made her completely unlikable. Not that that's any justification, obviously. And for the record, she doesn't actually get, you know, there's just, there's the beginning of assault before it stopped. But nobody's ever told the story of the unlikable girl, I don't think. And that's really what she is. She's very, very type A, very driven, rationalizes all her decisions, right or wrong, and she's not well-liked by the general community. So I thought that was just such a unique angle to go with that, with the story, and it just kind of took on a life of its own. And the biggest compliment I get when people finish the book is, number one, they say, it did not go where I expected it to go.
Mm-hmm.
And the second one I always get is complete polar opposite feedback about the character Gina French herself. Some people are like, she's the greatest, you know, protagonist I've ever read. And other people are like, I hated her.
Yeah.
And the fact that I wrote a character that forces you to insert your own, you know, personal feelings and experiences to help fill out the character is the biggest accomplishment I've taken away from it.
Well, I think having a character who's this strong and this defined is an accomplishment on its own.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, especially, I mean, you're going into a book and you have an expectation, like you do going into a movie or like a TV show like Breaking Bad, for instance. You just expect you're going to sympathize with this person. So you cut them a lot of slack because you're like, well, it's the hero, and we're socialized to expect that, until finally you're just like, you know what? This guy is an ass. Like,
right.
I hate him.
It starts out like she's a correctional officer, right? And that wasn't by mistake. When I first wrote the first story arc of this, I was watching a lot of Oz by, you know, HBO's prison drama from 20 years ago or whatever. And they were the masters of pulling that. You had this collection of unlikable people, but then they'd start telling their stories. And you'd see their backstories and why they were this way. And you'd slowly champion them. And you'd be like, come on, buddy, come on. And you'd cheer them on to victory. Then right at the end, they'd throw it all away. And you'd be like, right. You're a murderer. You're a terrible person. Why was I fooled into backing you?
Mm-hmm.
And I tried to bring some of that into the character of Gina French, but didn't completely pull the trigger. Again, she's pretty gray area. She's doing things, and you're constantly questioning why she's doing them.
Mm-hmm.
Is she doing them for the right reasons, or is she doing them because she's a horrible person? But she's justifying everything as she goes along. Whether you follow her down the path of justification or not is up to you as the reader.
So the book also, it's got Gina French is the point of view character for the first, I want to say, third half?
Yep.
And then you move into other people's points of view. Was that something that you were planning on doing, or just something that happened as it went?
Kind of both. It definitely wasn't at the beginning. It was going to be told completely from her perspective. But the more I was writing it, the more it was about perspective. As the other characters were mingling with her, you know, she didn't like certain ones. And I kept thinking, how do they perceive her?
Yeah.
So I thought, why don't we flip it on its head halfway through and tell the story from other people's point of views. Interesting fact, right up until I think two nights before it was published in ebook form first, this thing was only 6 chapters. The first 3 were Gina.
Yeah.
And then the next 3 were Travis, Connor, and Hannah.
Yeah.
And Kraken Press rode that right till the very end and decided not to go with 6 chapters. Chapter 2 was half of the book. It was, again, as you know, out there as the title was, like, let's have this huge $83,000 word novel cut into 6 chapters. Why do you want people to put it down? Why do you want to give people a chance to be like, okay, here's a natural break. I'm going to put a bookmark in here and go do something else.
Mm-hmm.
Take that away. How has nobody done that?
That's the thing. Like, you're very much playing around with expectations and kind of with the form. Like, even in the writing, some of the sentence structures are, like, very fragmented. There's, like, repeated sentences.
Yep.
So it's very experimental, I want to say.
It's hard for me not to write like that because I made television for 10 years, and that was always the criticism I got from people who went through the book, were like, you're writing like television.
Yeah.
You know, you're hearing this thing repeating, this line repeating through her mind constantly, because you can get away with that in television.
Yeah.
But writing it in print form, people are skipping that. They're skipping it constantly. They're no longer even reading that line because you've had it 6 times this page.
Mm-hmm.
So that was it was a learning curve for me, definitely.
Well, and it's your first book.
Yes.
So did you write before you wrote this book, or was this your first writing?
This was my first giant project. I had always written stuff, you know, funny things, Facebook posts that were way too long, although Facebook wasn't a thing when I started writing this, but you know what I mean? I'd always had fun doing little things, but never anything serious.
Mm-hmm.
And even when I first wrote, something really inspired me back in like 2003, I think it was. And I stayed up all night drinking coffee. I worked nights back then. And on one of my nights off, I scribbled like just a very skeleton story arc of this on napkins.
Yeah. So like J.K. Rowling style.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. And then kind of put it away and forgot about it. And It wasn't until I became a dad in 2006 and then stumbled upon it again, and I was reading it, my notes, more laughing at myself, writing from the perspective of a character, like a paranoid parent.
Yeah.
And how wrong I got it. And how what I perceived the paranoia of parenthood to be was so far off from what it actually is. But the more I read the notes, the more I just kind of thought, you know, I should probably flesh this out. This is actually pretty good.
Yeah.
And, you know, as I went along, gave it to some friends, and they kept, you know, cheerleading me on. And here we are.
Yeah.
Published book.
Which is super exciting. And it's got the most random publisher.
Yeah.
In Sweden.
Gothenburg, Sweden's Kraken Press picked it up. The very first publishing house I submitted it to in 2010.
When you're just a young, naive beginning.
But I sent it out. Like, I researched. For probably 6 months, honestly.
Yeah.
Just publishing houses that would take unsolicited work, because I didn't have an agent, obviously, and what would be a good fit. And I wanted to be really knowledgeable if they reached back out to me and be like, I liked this book and I thought it would be a good fit because you published this. And I settled on this one in the States somewhere originally. That was my first choice. And I sent it to them and I had a nice letter. And they actually replied and said they would look through it further, but it seems like a good fit. And they'll get back to me in summer and they're, you know, going to take it. I was like, wow, first, you know.
Why do people say writing is hard? Right?
And so I strutted around for 6 months like I was the greatest writer in the world. And of course, you know what's coming. The other shoe dropped. August came around. I got an email that said they decided not to for whatever reason. And then I went through a really, really painful 2-year rejection period before I finally stumbled across Kraken, which is a pretty new publishing company out in Gothenburg, Sweden. But they dealt in horror anthologies.
Like exclusively.
Pretty much, right? Yeah. This was their first novel, which is not even a fit for their publishing
house. It's not even horror.
No, really. Not really.
Yeah.
So, but again, I did a lot of research and kind of pitched it. It was like, I really like what you guys are doing. I really like the themes and the styles of your books, and your art is phenomenal. I really want to work with you guys. And they read it over, and I don't know if there's a voting process or whatever, but yeah, they sent me a contract to sign.
Was it in Swedish?
No, they're actually pretty fluent.
Signing your life away.
There was a few editing things though, where they didn't understand some slang,
right?
Which is understandable.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
man, being sent a contract, that's pretty, you know, that's up there for life moments.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it makes a 2-year struggle worthwhile, right? Anywhere in that 2 years, did you think about just like throwing in the towel?
Oh, constantly.
Yeah.
It was so hard to keep motivated. But what kept me going was a lot, well, not a lot, but probably every second or third rejection, they would be like, holy cow, kid. Like, this is someone young and hungry, swinging for the fences. We can't take it. We don't know what to do with this book. Our readers will, you know, fall over if we try to push this book, but keep trying.
Yeah.
Someone will take this. And I was really, really honored by that. Because again, you know, I didn't sit there and think I was going to be a writer my whole life. It wasn't my goal. It wasn't, I'm going to quit my job as soon as I'm published and become a full-time writer.
Mm-hmm.
It just kind of happened.
Yeah. Well, so the book itself, like, it doesn't fit easily into any genre, really. Like I was saying before, it's like there's a lot of inventive sort of unusual aspects to it, but it's published by this horror publisher. So I'm like, when are the vampires going to come in? And they do not, spoiler.
I had one publisher actually give me some quote advice that I should add a werewolf. It was a werewolf or a vampire.
Yeah.
And I blinked at the screen of my email for a good solid minute before I didn't even reply.
Yeah. Like, but just to make it fit, just so people could be like, okay, it's this
genre. I get that.
Yeah.
It really doesn't fit into genre. And that came up a lot too. A lot of publishing houses asked what it was. You know, check one box and I couldn't. It's true crime. It's thriller. It's kind of horror.
Yeah. It's kind of like fiction true crime.
Yeah.
Is kind of how it feels.
But it's not a true story.
Right. So it's just crime.
Crime.
I don't know.
And if you want to read something where you feel like you need a bath after, that's for you.
It's sort of got noir-ish sort of aspects, like a Coen Brothers sort of thing as well.
Sure.
Sort of like Coen Brothers crossed with Chuck Palahniuk. I don't know.
Wow, I never want to leave here. Thank you so much.
It's just did so much its own thing. I don't know. That's what I find interesting. And so it's really great that it's probably inevitable that it would land with just an offbeat publisher like it did. because, well, I mean, we were talking a bit before we started recording, just the publishing industry right now, like, it's all sequels and remakes, the same as it is with movies and TV. Like, it's hard for people to like, get out on a limb for something new and different. But which, that's... I mean, makes business sense, but it's not good for aspiring authors.
But the page always has to turn, right? And I'm not saying I'm changing publishing, you know, I'm not turning it on its head or anything, but there's always going to be that one that's willing to take the risk.
And it's going to be a new publisher like this. Yeah.
I was pretty sure, like, HarperCollins or Random House wasn't going to answer my email and agree to stock it, but, you know, who knows? Maybe this will be where it goes a few years from now. There's, you know, it starts to have a little more of an edge and is a little less safe as a whole from publishing companies. One of the best compliments I actually got was from another gentleman here in the city that writes, and he said, this is the kind of book that major publishing companies should be putting out. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily this book, but this type of book. Something just different to get people's attention.
Yeah.
Be like, wow, this is not your, you know, cookie cutter book that most publishing houses are playing it safe and putting out right now.
Are you a big reader yourself?
I try to be. I do. I do, but time's pretty limited for me right now. Yeah,
but I mean, you have been.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Read lots of books. Read some Jack Ketchum and Stephen King, you know, a lot of horror books.
Yeah.
But, yeah, there's probably bits of influence in, of them in here, too. But just kind of pulling from all aspects of life. Parenthood, horror, thriller, right?
A little bit of everything.
Well,
so when you were in the writing process, I mean, you were saying it's your first kind of major project. So if you can cast yourself back before all of the publishing and rejection and everything.
The good times?
Yeah. So how was it writing the book?
It was fun. I'm not going to lie. The editing wasn't fun. We edited it for two years after before we really started submitting it. But writing was fun. I mean, I was living the dream. I was a brand new dad. So, you know, get home from work. Tire the little boy out. He'd inevitably crash at like 7 o'clock because he was one or two, right?
Yeah.
And then just grab the laptop and go to the Broadway Roastery, name drop, and sit there and write.
Yeah.
You know, drink coffee till midnight. Go home, try to get some sleep. Get up at 5 with a baby and do it all again the next day. It was exciting. It was exciting because I'd get something done and send it to a few friends that I knew weren't just gonna like cheerlead me for no reason.
Yeah.
And there were things they hated and there were things they liked. I actually ended up completely rewriting the entire part about Connor, which is, I thought I had gold the first time with some of my favorite stuff, but everybody just unanimously was like, this is bad.
Yeah.
It was really good up till this, and now this is just almost pandering. Okay. Let's change it.
Well, and that's something I've read. I think Neil Gaiman, in a list of writing advice, he said something, you know, if a couple people say something, you know, consider it. But if everybody says the same thing is wrong, it's like, okay,
yeah,
you need
definitely.
To pay attention to that. Like, you can't be so, I mean, it's good to be confident in your writing, but you need to kind of trust other people's judgments. If everyone is like, this does not work, it's like, okay.
Absolutely. And I know so many people that just won't listen.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's also heartbreaking because I know so many, you know, talented people that have read their work, but it's not going to happen for them because of that reason. There's just no change.
They
just cross their arms and go, well, I'm right and everybody else is wrong. And okay.
Yeah. And I think there's sometimes people, I mean, it's good to be passionate about your own work, but if you're just like so emotionally invested in it, you can't change a single word, then where are you going to go?
I never thought the title would end up on the book. I never thought Gina French Is Not a Waste of Roofies would be the actual title.
Yeah.
But that's going to open the door for someone who's willing to negotiate maybe a title that's not quite a 10 out of 10, but an 8 out of 10.
Yeah.
Because everything I could pitch would be less offensive than that. Right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's all, like I said, give and take. You gotta be confident, like you said, but you also have to be willing to play the game. Or go to the self-publish route, which was...
Yeah, which is always an option as well. Yep. So many people in Saskatoon are doing that. Some of them extremely successfully, like Wes Funk, for instance.
Love Wes Funk.
Marin Mutella. I mean, they're doing phenomenally well with self-publishing. But I can see going with a traditional publisher takes a lot of the pressure off of you, right?
Yep. Ironically, dealing with a publisher in Gothenburg, Sweden, I've pretty much ended up doing a lot of stuff self-publishers do.
anyways, not doing a lot of like promotion for you in Saskatoon.
No, it turns out Gothenburg, Sweden doesn't have the Market Mall Kohl's number on speed dial. So yeah. I've been a go-between for most of the local bookstores here, but it's okay.
Do they have other North American authors?
I don't think so. I think they have one other gentleman from the States.
Yeah.
So
it's really like they must have felt so passionately about this book, like to take it on as the first novel, as a non-horror and from a guy in Saskatoon.
Yeah. It was humbling. It was exciting.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, getting that actual contract, because it's one thing to be, oh yeah, we're going to send you something. You know, I'd heard that before.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'd been through that.
Yeah.
That road 2 years before that and had the rug pulled out and always had positive feedback and then nothing and positive feedback. So when Kraken pressed, oh, we're going to email you a contract, it was, my walls were so high at that time. I was like, yeah, no, you're not.
Yeah, yeah,
no,
exactly.
You're not. And of course, I wasn't emailing them back. I was like, let me know when you're sending it. And they're like, we will. But in my mind, I was like, this isn't going to happen. And then to actually double click that thing and open it up and take it to my lawyer friend who read it over.
Yeah.
I was like, whoa, that's pretty big league stuff.
Yeah.
So.
So how has it been, the reaction to the book? You talked a bit about it. But...
It's been good. Again, it's a little bit of a hard sell locally. I'm in with a lot of local authors who write about, you know, Saskatchewan, which is awesome.
Yeah.
Power to them. But this book doesn't even take place in
Canada. Oh, that's
Canada.
My question, too. So where does it take place?
It takes place in the United States.
So like
kept it
generic...
very vague.
Yeah, yeah.
And... that was something that, again, I'm not knocking anybody, but I never, as myself writing, I never got inserting locations, like hard locations, into your work. I wanted it to be accessible for everyone.
Well, and that's the thing. Unless there's a certain reason it takes place in Saskatoon because, you know, some part of history is going to tie in. That's what they do a lot in some TV shows. You see books for children sometimes. It's just like, it's this city.
Yeah.
Like, they don't say... where Sesame Street is. It's just like, so you can imagine it's in your own city.
I adore Copeland, but I always get annoyed because he's always forever talking about these little obscure places in Vancouver.
Yeah.
I've been to Vancouver once in my life. I was like, dude, I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
You wasted a paragraph explaining to me we're essentially, you know, having a commercial for a place in Vancouver that I'm never going to be. And
yeah.
It just kicks me out of the story. So I was really, really careful not to do that in here. I kept it very... very generic. I wanted every reader to think this is my town.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, no, I agree too. Like there's some books where they just throw in the name of a street where it's like, you didn't have to say the name of the street. You could have said he went around the corner.
Yeah.
But you just throw in the street so people who live there can be like, oh yeah.
Look at me. Yeah.
I know that street. Yeah.
Which is great if you live here.
Yeah.
But, you know, if I made this essentially a book about someone living in Saskatoon, does someone in Alberta want to read it? Probably not.
Yeah.
Someone in Sweden want to read it? No.
So what was the editing like with the team in Sweden? Because you worked with an editor before you submitted it, right?
Yeah, definitely. I had a couple people locally go through it that I really trusted and gave me some good advice and forced some rewrites. And then it went to Kraken, and we were all set to launch it. And I can't remember the correct reason, but they decided to bump it behind their next anthology.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly... greatest thing that ever happened.
Yeah.
It was frustrating at the time because basically it was, here we go. It's going to be November.
Yeah.
So
well, I mean, you've been waiting for
so
long.
Everybody excited. It's going to be November. And then it was, no, sorry. It's going to be, you know, another 6 to 9 months or whatever.
Yeah.
And it got put on the back burner and I was a little heartbroken, but I walked away for a good 8 months. Didn't think about it. Didn't read it. Didn't look at it. And then when they reached out to me and said, okay, let's sit down with this again. Let's make this happen sooner than later. We both went through it a second time, and probably I myself cut another 7,000 words.
Yeah.
Just actually reading it as a reader, not the author. I had never done that before.
Well, like having that time off. Yeah, you could really have the distance. It's not so close to... Yeah.
I would, you know, before that, I would sit there and read the same paragraph over and over and over until it lost all its meaning.
Yeah.
But that was my opportunity to come back, read it from beginning to end as a reader, not the author, and pick out why is this happening. At one point, I swear to God, it took her 2 pages to walk around the corner of the cabin. And I was, how? Why would I write this?
Yeah.
How has nobody pointed out? Nothing has happened in 2 pages. This is terrible. So
yeah,
that was the most important edit. And I'm so glad it got pushed back. It allowed both of us, their editor and myself, to hack much needed fat out of this book.
Yeah. So, I mean, sort of a blessing in disguise.
Absolutely.
You wouldn't have seen it that way when you got the news.
No.
But in retrospect.
Luckily, it happened. No.
Yeah. Yeah, so the book is available all over the place. Where can people get a copy?
It is available in all the Kohl's here in Saskatoon, in Chapters, Indigo. I guess it's Indigo, not Chapters, right?
Chapters Indigo.
Chapters Indigo, McNally Robinson, Unreal City, and Main Stage Clothing in Lawson Heights Mall.
That's the mall or the store where they sell sort of like the funky baby clothes with
And jewelry
like and bands on them and stuff. Yeah.
It's like the world's coolest garage sale. Just random stuff in there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And then online as well. People can get it from Amazon.
Yeah. It's actually been getting some good. It's on barnesandnoble.com too and amazon.com, amazon.ca. I've been getting some pretty good feedback on Amazon sites.
Yeah.
It makes me feel good.
Well, that's good. So, I mean, people, so it's not just your friends and people in Saskatoon reading it.
Like
that's interesting to see what would somebody think about this book who don't know you,
who
don't know who you are.
There was I got some pretty intense Twitter hatred when it was first announced, just on the title alone, but we all expected that.
Yeah.
You know,
well, that's half of the reason to do.
Read the book.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, I've had people reach out to me privately and tell me they enjoyed it I don't know where these people are from.
Yeah.
It's, again, completely humbling.
Mm-hmm. If there is one sort of message that you want people to get from this book, what would it be?
Oh, a message.
You know, if you finish reading this book, what do you want them to be thinking or feeling?
Wow. No one's ever asked me that before. I didn't write it with a lesson in mind, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I just let the story keep going and I guess don't judge people on their actions.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know what's going on behind the scenes. That's such a lame answer. I'm sorry. I want to do better at this question.
I don't know. I would say something similar. Something like people are more complex than what you might assume.
Absolutely. But.
Which, I don't know. I think at its heart, every book has sort of a lesson that's really basic like that anyway.
I guess the lesson you can learn from Gina French is to not stay down. Mm-hmm. Just keep, what is it? Kick at the darkness till it bleeds daylight.
Yeah. Well, and that's kind of what the title, I mean, which is attention getting as it is. I mean, it's her saying like, no, you know, I'm important. I'm valuable.
Yes.
Yeah. Like she's just someone who will not stay down.
She's someone who has to constantly tap into bad things that have happened to her to push her forward, to try to make good things happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess maybe that's the message. Take everything that's wrong in your life and use it as motivation, not a crutch.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, I pulled it off after all that.
Look at that.
See, it took me. it took me 30 seconds, but I got there.
Yeah.
It took me 2 pages to get around the cabin, but we're there.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you so much for this honor. It was great.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic. So Gina French is not a waste of roofies. If you forget the title exactly, if you go into McNally, you're like, do you have the roofies book?
They'll know.
They'll know what you mean. You change your position, and you're changing me. As Curtis mentioned, you can pick up a copy of Gina French Is Not a Waste of Roofies as a book at basically all of the bookstores here in Saskatoon, as well as an ebook on the major online retailers as well. You can learn more about his book and this press, Kraken Press, at krakenpress.com. My name is Anne Foster. This is Radio Book Club on CFCR, and I'll talk to you all next week. We're interrupted by the heat of the sun, trying to break